He came from the Middle East. He was a failed asylum seeker. He had, we were told, converted to Christianity. Now it's claimed that the Home Secretary, Priti Patel, is saying that basically he was, like many others, using, it would appear, our dysfunctional asylum system to game the system. Home Office sources have said that he, like many, have been converting to Christianity simply as a way of mounting an appeal against being deported. He, of course, lost his asylum seeker claim in 2014, and yet 7 years later, still in the country, despite actually brandishing a knife and being sectioned at one point for mental health problems after losing his asylum appeal. Let's talk to Dr. Alan Mendoza. He's an executive director of the Henry Jackson Society. Good morning to you, Alan.
Good morning, Julia.
We spoke to you earlier this week when we were just getting news about this man and getting his identity and what had actually happened on the day. We're now learning a lot more about it. What do you make of this claim from Priti Patel, the Home Secretary, and other Home Office sources, this idea that they're asylum seekers, you know, they fail, they need a ground for appeal. And this allegation, in front of the Telegraph, being very clear, that, you know, the Church of England is basically giving them information and helping them and deliberately helping them to supposedly convert to Christianity, and that this was happening in Liverpool Cathedral, where this man apparently converted, as a way of staying in the country, gaming the system. Priti Patel criticising the Human Rights Act, criticising the lawyers in the past, and also now criticising our dysfunctional system. Is she right?
Well, yeah, of course she's right. I mean, this is an extraordinary turn-up of events. I mean, it's probably not surprising, judging by the asylum legal system that's built up and the industry that's built up around trying to keep asylum seekers who failed in their bids to come to the UK staying here. And of course, this conversion issue is one of them. It's interesting to note it's not simply Priti Patel saying this. Church figures within the very cathedral where he was converted have stated that they are suspicious of the number of converts who've come through. And of course, there is then the question of why the church is engaged in this activity when it knows that it's being gamed as part of it. These people may well not be genuine converts. So the whole thing is a mess. And it just shows you why we've got to crack down on this system to make sure that people who are coming into this country and who are then refused entry are then deported and not allowed to find reasons to stay when they've already been rejected.
Yeah, indeed. I mean, and this is the thing. We just spoke to, in the last half hour, Lord Carlisle, who's the former reviewer of terrorism legislation, and he said it was outrageous for Priti Patel to blame the church or to blame the courts. And he said it was tosh and nonsense that things like the Human Rights Act, which is often blamed, is preventing us from having a working system. Do you think he's right or is she right there?
Well, Lord Carlisle is entitled to his view, but the reality is we have a case here of somebody who was repeatedly denied asylum in this country, who underwent a conversion route that we are told by people in that church is viewed as suspect, and who then committed a terrorist atrocity on these shores. I'm not sure we need more evidence than that. The system is broken. Yeah. How many terrorist atrocities, you know, do we need before we think that actually there might be a problem with the system as it stands at the moment?
And we're often told, aren't we, you know, that people who are concerned about, you know, asylum seekers, failed asylum seekers, migrants, particularly, you know, the Channel migrants being talked about, that, you know, more than 1,100 turning up on Thursday alone last week. I mean, terrifying numbers, frankly, and which we're told actually by experts, actually, these are not unusual numbers coming over. They used to just go through routes that weren't quite so visible. We just couldn't get it on camera, so we weren't really aware of it. But this huge number of people who are undocumented a lot of the time, that, you know, this man, you know, apparently the Ahmad al-Suhaiman, he has an Iraqi mother, a Syrian father, but he'd come from Jordan. The reason he failed in his asylum seeking pledge was because he was actually an economic migrant from Jordan and therefore was not eligible for asylum. But we're often told that, but saying that this is an issue and this is a danger for our society, that is, you know, huge numbers of young men, we've got no idea who they are or where they've come from or what their motives are, coming into this country. Some, yes, desperate, some hoping to form a new life. Some, I'm sure some of them will end up being heart surgeons eventually. But the reality is, you know, we don't know whether more people like Suhaiman are coming on boats and arriving here and getting to stay here. And we don't know what their motive is or why they're here or what they're going to do. That's not xenophobic or racist or unreasonable to have those concerns, is it?
No, of course it isn't. And look, you start off with the key premise, which is these are illegal immigrants. It's not someone railing about the state of legal immigration and going, oh, bloody foreigners, they want to see them, you know, on the shores. These are people who have failed in their legal attempt to this come to this country, which I don't think anyone would have any problem with if they passed in that way. And instead, they have tried to stay in this country illegally and extend their stay in whatever way. And we have many of these cases coming in, as you've highlighted. And as you say, we don't know who they are because they're not documented properly. We don't know what they believe or what they intend to do here. And we don't know, in this particular instance, if they're capable of, you know, kind of committing terrorist atrocities. That is not the way for any country to behave. It's not a xenophobic issue. It's a national security issue.
Alan Mendoza, really appreciate you joining us. Executive Director of the Henry Jackson Society.